Well, good evening to you and welcome to this program of Walter Rodney Groundings. I'm your host, Dion Abrams, and I have two special ladies with me this evening. And we'll be looking at Creolese as a language in Caribbean societies. And with me to discuss that are Dr. Tamirand Nina DeLissa and Charlene Wilkinson, whom we all know. But before we talk about Creolese as a language in Caribbean societies, I just want to remind you of the Pan-African Movement's Day of the African Child Concert, which will be held on June 18 at the Queen's College Auditorium. And of course, the MC for that concert will be Basil Bradshaw. And we have lots of artists who will be participating in that concert. Those who go there every year know that you're usually in for a great trip. And so we have the House of Israel Culture Corps. We have Anu Abrams, the PC Steel Band. We have Petal Bourne and a whole host of other artists who will be making your afternoon one that is truly pleasant. So don't forget that date, June 18, at the Queen's College Auditorium for the Day of the African Child Concert. That's an annual event put on by the Pan-African Movement. Now, the two ladies I have here are both attached to the University of Guyana. Dr. Tamirand is Jamaican, and our Charlene Wilkinson, they're here to discuss a course that they're planning at the university, but of course we'll talk about other aspects of Creole as a language in the Caribbean society. Well, what is the course about that you are planning for this summer at the university? Dr. Tamirand, would you want to tell me?
Sure. So we're doing a course, the Introduction in Writing Creolese, and this course is expected to run from the 12th of June until the 30th of June. It will be held on both campuses, at Tain and Turkine. At Tain campus, we'll be doing it on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 3 to 6, and at Turkine, it will be on Mondays and Wednesdays from from 5 to 8. We specifically put the course at this hour because we're hoping to get people who are working people, and as such, yes, we hope that we have people will be able to come after work.
So, Charlene, is there a cost attached to the course?
Yes, there's a cost attached. It's $20,000. You get a certificate at the end, but we are asking not to let the money daunt you. If you are interested in coming to this course, do not let the money be a block. Call us and let us know that you're interested.
So, who are the people that you're targeting for this particular course? It's Creolese.
Yes, we're going to be teaching for the first time in an institutional setting. Actually, for the first time in Guyana, we'll be teaching people how to write the Creolese language. We already have people writing it. People who are creative writers, they're already writing it. But they are using the spelling they learned to write in English. We are going to be teaching a writing system specially designed for the Creolese language. And we are asking that you don't think you need to have a degree or many subjects in CXE or CAPE. As long as you believe you're a confident speaker of Guyanese Creole, you can attend this course. You don't even have to have an education as such. We want people who are confident speakers of Creolese to attend the course. We expect to have a wide assortment of people in the course, from media workers to teachers to civil servants to creative writers, anybody who is interested in this whole issue of us having our own language can attend the course. Would you like to add anything to that?
No, but I'm wondering, because Dr. Tamirand is Jamaican, you're Guyanese,
yes.
You're teaching Guyanese.
Yes.
We have some sense that Jamaican Creole is not the same, but not distinctly different from Guyanese Creole. So how do we have the compatibility in relation to those two different?
Why am I bringing this foreigner into the class? I'm glad you asked the question, because her expertise, she is in fact a very highly qualified linguist.
All right.
And she has made herself well known in her own country and internationally too, because she's translated two full-length English classics into Guyanese Creole, into Jamaican Creole, so that her experience as a translator comes in here. And having anybody that studies any one of the Creoles will be more effective in teaching a Creole in another country, because the grammars are very, very similar. The languages operate very similar to each other. The greatest differences would be in the lexicon, the vocabulary.
So Dr. Tamiran, these two books, I see you have two books here. Tell us something about these books that you have translated into Jamaican Creole.
Okay, first of all, these two books, I find them to be very precious to me, in the sense that it allows the Jamaican people to have material in their own language. They're able to read in their own language, because these stories, in particular, Alice Adventures in Wonderland, that one in particular, most Jamaicans grow up reading that book as a child in English. So having these material in their own language allows them to be more involved pretty much in the content of the story, being able to relate to it better. And it's good for the language in the sense that it allows Jamaican Creole, written Jamaican Creole, to be pretty global, because these books were done internationally. One, Alice Adventures in a Wonderland, as we would say in Jamaica, it's done in Ireland, and The Little Prince is done in Switzerland.
But tell me, how difficult was it to translate the English language to Jamaican Creole when you have, well, names would not be difficult to reproduce, Twiddly D and Twiddly Dum and so on, but I mean, some of the descriptions, because Alice is full of imagery, right? And as you move from one place to the other, there is all kinds of imagery and characterization.
There are a lot of metaphors and similes that you have in English, which was a bit challenging, I must admit, to translate, and also to get the rhymes back together and all of that. Generally, while I take credit for translating the book, I must say that I would always rely on my friends and family back home. Because while translating, I would tend to text them to find out, how is this? Sounds good to you? How would we say that? I mean, even though I have my own impression that, yes, this could be said in this manner, I know maybe it could be said in that manner also, which one sound better, that kind of thing. And I would always be on the phone with them, getting feedback in terms of, in ensuring that the quality of the book is what we expect. Most of the translation wasn't as difficult as compared to translating in other languages, based on the fact that Jamaican Creole is English lexified. So a lot of the things in terms of the rhymes and so on, it was easier for me to maintain because of the closeness between both languages, also in terms of the lexicon.
But Charlene, as a linguist,
A teacher.
Okay.
Yes. Learning linguistics.
Creole, the argument is that these languages are not fully developed. Pidgin, Creole, you know, standard. And we have a translation here, and the doctor is saying that it is effective in relating to a standard, a classic like Alice in Wonderland, mm-hmm. that the Creole could have been adopted mm-hmm. to that kind of book. Has Creole elevated itself to such a level in the Caribbean that we can really say that it can represent
the standard
English?
The thing is, I let Tamir add to this, but I would start out by saying that the notion that a language has to develop in a way a child does, it's based on a misconception about language. It assumes that languages grow like children and grow from infancy to childhood to adulthood. I'm not sure that that is an adequate, accurate scientific description of what language is. I think it's based on the false conception that the Creole speakers would eventually speak English because they're coming from this backward language that is moving towards English. It's a feeling that we still have, and I think even in the school system, people are still bandying that notion at the back of their heads when they treat children. So even to the way the children's classrooms are structured, you walk into a classroom, you tend to find the ones who speak more English up in the front on the teacher's pets, and the ones who are real basilectual, rural type speakers sitting in the back. And that mirrors the false notion that the Creole language is moving in some direction, it's growing, it's evolving. That is not true. I'm going to really ask you to add to this as the technical person on board. Yes.
Just one little thing, which you mentioned that the language in itself is not evolving.
I would not necessarily
agree that it's not evolving, but
it is not
moving
towards
English.
Exactly.
It is not moving towards English because generally languages change. Right. In the case of Creole, what you said earlier about it not being, you know, like a full-fledged language, that is not true. That's a misconception that we have as Creole speakers, that our language is not on par, is not equal to English or any other European language. And that definitely is not true. In terms of the language itself, what the language can do, there's nothing that English can do that Creole can't do. You might probably want to argue your point in the sense that, all right, we don't get the equality that we need or that should be, because in the Guyanese society, in Jamaica also, we have English being the official language and Creole being swept under the carpet. Even though majority of the population speaks Creole, English is still the official language. Generally, speakers would leave Jamaica or Guyana in that sense, and if you ask them, what language do you speak? Or even in Jamaica, what language do you speak? It is always English. It is never Creole.
Okay.
But when you check them to see whether they're real competent, if you try to find out if they could actually produce English, they will be telling you in Creole that they speak English. So, okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, that comes with the classification, because as linguists, we normally classify. Well, I don't know what's happening now. I left university doing linguistics since 1993 or 92 or something like that.
That's not too long. That's not too long ago.
But you have English Creole, you have French Creole, you have.
Exactly.
Right, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then we talk about Pidgin and Patois and so on. Pidgin, English, Patois. During the period of study when I was doing it, we saw those as languages evolving towards Creole and moving towards the standard. What is the current view in relation to that movement?
So there is the idea of the pidgin. Mm-hmm. Of course, there are different views.
Okay.
So you have different theories. Not all theory believe that Creole originate from pidgin.
Yeah.
But that
okay.
is one theory where we have the pidgin, and then children who are born into the pidgin situation who need to speak, who need to communicate, because the pidgin, remember, it was just a contact language for dealing with business. So I need to speak to you about this trade that we're doing, and I have to, we have to form a language somewhat to communicate.
So it's baby children, talk.
No, it's not baby talk. It's different from baby talk. But children who are born in that situation, they need a bit more. So they are believed to develop what we have today as the Creole language.
Okay.
So, for example, you'd have in the pidgin mainly lexical items. So concrete stuff that you can see. So that's a phone, that's a desk, that's a camera, things like that. Children who need to communicate now have to develop functional items. These are the little things that carry no direct meaning within themselves. So for example, instead of phone, they would say the phone. Stuff like, just basics.
Okay.
Right. So, in terms, coming back to your question, in terms of the book, whether there is a standard way or something, if language has evolved to that level now, it's not just now, it's been there for a while. So there is the writing system. Initially, from the 1950s, 60s, you have Cassidy LePage, who come up with the writing system for Jamaican Creole.
Okay.
That was modified from then by linguists who are writing in Guyanese Creole, because as you mentioned before, both languages are similar.
Okay.
So of course, with a little modification, it applies to Guyanese Creole. But this knowledge was never shared with the mainstream population. So our course now that we hope to have will pretty much be doing that, sharing this knowledge that linguists have been using over the years to write with the general public. So it is the same writing system that I have used in translating my books. It's the same writing system that the Bible has been translated in. And pretty much people are now becoming more warm to the system, where you can see it in newspapers. Some people will write it in newspapers. But yeah, still we have people writing what they would call chaka chaka, using English spelling to write Guyanese Creole or Jamaican Creole. I don't know, in terms of arguing whether the Creole is on par to English. In terms of the varieties, of course, we have different varieties of Creole. Likewise, there are different varieties of English. So even though at this point we probably would not have one specific variety that we believe should be the standard variety, but we have the variety that is used to translate the Bible, which is the same variety that I use to translate my books.
Okay, but I mean, you still speak Patois in Jamaica?
Yes, I do.
So what's the difference between the Patois and the Creole?
Oh, well, there is no difference between what we call Jamaican Patois and Jamaican Creole. It is, Patois is just a more affectionate name. Jamaicans, we call it Patois. Creole, Jamaican Creole is a name, is a word used by linguists. That's it.
So
the average man on the street will tell you Patois. The linguist will prefer to say Jamaican Creole.
Okay, so that the Patois is not a part of the continuum from Pidgin?
The Patois is just the name that we call it.
Just like we say Creoleese.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
And our linguists would prefer to say Guyanese. They don't even like to add Creole. Now, Mervyn Aline, for example, he hated the word Creole. He said our language is Jamaican and Guyanese and Trinidadian and Antiguan. You know, he would say, this is our nation, this is our language. Because it is this very distinct languages.
Yeah, but that's interesting. I'm happy that you were saying this, but the writing, Dr. Tamrian just said that scripts have been developed in relation
to writing systems.
Writing systems.
Yes.
And you were saying that we're still using the British system.
Right.
How do the morphology, the phonology, the syntax,
right, well,
how do all those things?
Yes, well, remember the point she made earlier is that the linguists developed the writing system, but educational authorities did not share the system with the public, with the school system. So I like to call it a closely guarded secret that only linguists have. So what, in fact, has been happening since the 40s, 50s, when people like Uncle Stapey, have you ever heard of Uncle Stapey? Uncle Stapey used to write in the Argosy since the early 50s.
No,
and actually, I have a nice collection of Uncle Stapey's work. But Uncle Stapey would use what he learned, how he learned to write. So if you're writing you, you're going to see me. He can say Y-U-H. But in, for example, give me a simple example, the H really is a silent letter. So in the writing system, what we've done is abolished silent letters. To write Creolese, you don't use silent letters. So we would change Uncle Stapey's Y-U-H to Y-U.
So what about there?
There would be D-E. So this is what we're going to...
But the children, when they see that, they're going to say D.
They're going to say
D. At least they do it in Spanish.
I don't agree that the children will say D. The children know that E in Creole pronounce E.
And in English accent, actually.
In English
they
too.
They learn the sound of E as E in English.
Mm-hmm. But yes. I find a difficulty in them saying they in Spanish or say or C or D.
They're two different languages operating, and the children pretty much, they know English, for example, in terms of the sound systems, they know Creole sound systems, right? So learning Spanish, they would try to apply what is known to them in their English or in their Creolese in terms of pronunciation, because they're learning the pronunciation system of Spanish, sorry. So until they are at that point where they're comfortable in pronouncing the words, if they're just looking at it, they will probably say what they would have said in English or in Creole.
Okay, well, I've been writing Creole. I write plays and I write Creole, but I use...
You use what you know.
Right. The same D-H and S-E-H and...
But the army would expect to see you in the course.
Really?
Yes.
I'd be happy to be there,
yes.
But time is a serious constraint for me in these times. To people who are listening, and the argument, we're in a society where people always say, talk properly. Mm-hmm. How are you going to convince people that this argument has been on for many years, that these are languages and they are languages in themselves, and that they should be given the prominence that they deserve, but we don't have an examination in Creole. The only way we use it is when we use direct speech for our story writing and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But we can't write an argument with Creole and an expository essay or a persuasive piece and get the kind of grade that we ought to get. So how do we deal with parents and children who have to prepare for this standard and try to get them to be comfortable with this Creole that we're talking about?
But Dion, when I did GCO levels, I wouldn't tell the audience which generation I did it in. But we were studying biology, where all the flowering plants were foreign. It is only many years later that you started to see hibiscus flowers show up in a biology text. So what I'm trying to say, using another subject, is that curriculum can change, you see? Just as how we have allowed syllabus A, we have allowed the section C, the story, short story, to be the children to use Creole. It doesn't take much more to say, well, okay, you can write an argument demonstrating. Even if you say you can write an argument using Creole in your in your evidence, in the evidence that you bring to support your argument. That's the simplest thing to do, to simply initiate a curriculum change. You're not changing the entire structure of it, but you're changing some elements of the content.
But are people going to be willing to accept this that we're trying to push here, that you need to be comfortable with this language? It's a language that belongs to you,
mm-hmm.
and that you should be comfortable using it. Because in the classroom, teachers tell children to speak the Queen's English, to mm-hmm. write in the Queen's language, and if you speak Creole, then you're basically hauled over the coals and
told. Yeah, that's what's happening
so
in the school
how
system
do we get
now.
Teachers, parents, and all those concerned mm-hmm. to feel comfortable with this language that we're talking about?
Well, my assessment is a bit harsh. When you go to the doctor and the doctor tells you you have an ailment, you literally accept that he's diagnosed you correctly. When you go to a linguist and a linguist tells you that your children are simply not making it in the school system because you have not acknowledged their mother tongues, you're not using their mother tongues, you're not beginning there, so that you're going to inhibit them learning anything else, the same applies. Please feel free to jump in and add. You know, the linguists are saying to us, educationists, researchers have shown us that if you want your children to be literate and they are Creole speakers, you have to make them literate in their mother tongues. That's how you learn how to handle narrative writing, academic writing, letter writing, because you begin with you begin with the one you know.
Yeah, do you want
to? I think uh-huh. definitely it will need a change of attitude.
Okay.
Overall, that's it. It needs a change of attitude. Until our attitudes change, until we start viewing Creole as a language in and of itself and distinct from English, we will be having this problem. In terms of even in the classroom, where you say that if you tell the child to speak properly, write properly, you should be speaking the Queen's English, for example. Most of the times, the teachers themselves are not speaking the Queen's English. The teachers themselves, most of the time, are not 100% competent in English. And if they need to get through to that Creole child, they will tell you too that they have to change, they have to switch. Speak Creole, get through to the child, and then they probably want to switch back to English because it shows that it is not effective teaching a child in a language that the child doesn't speak or doesn't necessarily understand.
If I may jump in too.
Yeah, sure.
There is a kind of dishonesty, hypocrisy at work, because I examined all the primary school timetables. And check it for me, unless they've been listening to me. Nowhere on those timetables do you have a subject called English. Now, I don't know if anybody will deny now in this 21st century that Creolese is a language. So if we're not denying that Creolese is a language, and we know that teachers use that language to reach children. I just finished a study where they told us, great majority said, they switched to Creole when they checked that the child is not understanding them. They would say it again in Creolese to make sure they understand. So, but what we're doing, while we promote the Creolese consciously or unconsciously, we need a program to teach English. And we also need to say to the children, because of the lexical overlap, because the languages seem to resemble each other, the children confuse the two. So we need something to pull them apart. We need a subject called English and a subject called Creolese. And the children begin, eventually children learn, children are born to be multilingual. The human species is born to be multilingual.
And I think until they develop literacy in the language, they will probably still have that problem not being able to dissect the two. Because when you can see, first thing, when you look at the language, you can see with your eyes that this is something different. This is not English at all. Mm-hmm. When you learn to write it, when you learn to read it, mm-hmm. you see that the structures are totally different. Mm-hmm. The way pluralization, for example, is expressed in English, you add a S to the noun. In Creole, we have a structured way of doing it, mm-hmm. just that the word them is used instead of the plural S. So and for every grammatical item, whatever it is, if it is past tense marking or future, you have a way to do it in English, you have a way to do it in Creole.
Well, very what qualifies a language? What makes something a language?
Basically, languages are means of communication. Well, means of communication by itself is not a good definition because you can communicate in other ways that you're not using language.
Okay.
But it is that biological system that comes with it, this innate ability to relate, to communicate, to relate to people generally. Because you would have cases of animals, and you would say, okay, but you can see the animals communicating, but they're not necessarily producing language.
Okay.
So, mm-hmm. go ahead.
No, I think what Dion is asking is, how do you say that those people over there who don't speak like you are speaking their own language? You know the honest answer? A linguist said it, I can't remember his name or her name. You will say, oh, they're speaking a little dialect. It's not a real language. And the linguist says, a language is a dialect with an army and a navy. Power.
Okay.
It's about power. If you have the power in the world, and you know, the fact is that the Jamaicans do. How they manage to do it is, we can study it. Is it their population? It couldn't really be. They're 2.5 million people. Is it their cultural confidence? I would say definitely we need to put that as a possibility. But everywhere you go in the world, you see people either trying to talk Jamaican or to create music like Jamaicans. I've seen a Muslim reggae band in full Muslim turbans and everything, Muslim. But the issue of us recognizing that we have a language first, that comes first. We don't have the army and the navy. You have the army and no navy, and the army is too small to be a world power. But we as a people have to recognize that we have a language.
Okay.
Otherwise, we will continually hold our children back.
We're going to open the phone lines shortly so that people can call and share their views on this topic. But the other thing that I want to focus on is because the linguist will tell you that there is a continuum, Creole continuum. Mm-hmm. You talk about acrolect, yes. Mesolect, basilect, and mm-hmm. so on. Mm-hmm. How does this continuum relate to writing? Acrolect is supposed to be something close to the mm-hmm. standard.
Yeah.
As we go to basilect, there's countryside gap,
right.
and so on.
Right, right.
So how do we, in terms of the syntax and mm-hmm. the morphology and the phonetics and all of that, how do we mm-hmm. juxtapose all of that into our writing and our
right.
speaking?
Well,
and so
well
on.
You know what? English does it. Mm-hmm. French does it. Any language does it. So when you teach, the first thing you learn when you learn a language is how they write their sounds. How does the French write? What does the letter A represent for the French? It represents A. As a matter of fact, A is quite universal in a sense, because A is A in French, in English, in Creolese, and I'm sure many other in Spanish too, right? Mm-hmm. So you learn how you represent the sounds by these symbols that we call letters, because we have an alphabetic writing system, unlike the Chinese who have a character writing system. So, but if you are writing how the people in Breton, France speak, you will not change it to a Parisian variety. You will write the Breton variety. The same thing in English. If you're writing a novel and you want to represent somebody in Manchester, you will write exactly how the people in Manchester speak. So those are called varieties of language, but you're using the same spelling system to spell the words, you see. So those issues are not problems, they're actually challenges, and they actually are what going to make the course exciting, you see. I mean, if I have a course, running a course, and everybody comes from South Rheinfeld, it's probably going to be boring.
Okay.
But if some people come from Buxton, some people come from Lusignan, some people come from West Bank, some people come from the British High Commission. So you have a wide range of people bringing their own varieties to the class. So you get a part of the class will have to be, how do you say that where you come from? Okay, so in addition to how you say it where you come from, we're also going to be looking at different texts that the linguists have collected over the years. Linguists have been collecting texts from over the years.
So, I ain't going there.
I ain't going there.
Me not go there.
That's definitely George. I ain't going there as Georgetown.
Right.
Right? That's what we would call the urban type,
okay,
variety. Me not go there. That would be the urban, the rural.
Right.
And what would you say in Jamaica?
Me not go there.
Same thing, me not go there.
Okay.
Yeah, right, so but we all would be writing it using those same sounds.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And we understand each other. Maybe.
And we, that's it, that's the beauty of it.
So communication takes place.
Communication.
And that is what a language is about.
Yes.
All right. This is interesting. Let me remind you about the Pan-African Movement Day of the African Child Concert, which will be held on June 18 at the Queen's College Auditorium. That's an annual concert by the Pan-African Movement. And the MC will be Mr. Basil Bradshaw. And we have a number of artists, including the House of Israel Culture Corps, Anu Abrams, the PC Steel Band, QC Steel Band, Petal Bourne, and a whole host of other artists will be there to entertain you. And the time for the concert is 4:00. Cost of ticket for adults is $300 and children are free. Oh boy, the phone is already going. All right, somebody wants to get through to us, but we'll hold the calls for a short while, so just try again, right? So try to be there, make your best effort to be there. It will be an evening of entertainment, and those who have been going there every year know that it's a real treat, and so we're looking forward to your presence once again at this, the Day of the African Child Concert. All right? So the content of the course, exactly what are you going to be focusing on in this course, really?
Well, we will be teaching you how to write.
Okay.
So that when you and that in itself is going to take a shift, because we know that the people who are coming into the course are already literate. This is probably one of the times when people who are literate will be going to be giving us problems. If you have somebody who can't write at all, the job will be much easier. Because once, if you're illiterate and you speak Creolese, we're teaching you as fresh. If you're literate and you speak English but you don't speak Creolese as well as English, you're going to have to make some shifts in your mind. But it wasn't hard for me. It took me a long time to actually learn it. Not because it wasn't easy to learn, but I didn't take the time to go practice it. So you can learn it, you actually learn it in about 15 minutes. But it's to practice it and to continue to produce it correctly that takes the time.
No, I grew up in Buxton. I mean, if I say, are we a go back?
Mm-hmm.
What do you understand it to mean?
Are we a go away?
Back.
Back down.
Okay.
Back.
Right, but if you're not acquainted with that kind of understanding, mm-hmm, how do you relate. I mean, the doctor is saying here that a youngster was asking you outside about getting one of the books, but you were saying that because it's Jamaican, you don't know how well he will be able to.
Well, I was hoping that he would try to read it nonetheless. I mean, the languages are similar. The okay. writing system is pretty much the same. The only thing is that there are certain combination of vowels that we would have in Jamaican mm-hmm. that they will not, that you will not have in Guyanese. But the core system is okay. the same. So even though you probably will not have a uo sound, you will still be able to recognize the uo when you see it, because you have u and you have o.
Okay.
So the core system is the same. So reading it would require a little conditioning of the mind. Of course, you know that I am not reading English. This is mm-hmm. Creole. Mm-hmm. And once you're past the first page, you're good. Everything else just flow.
How far has the language moved from Louise Bennett's?
I wouldn't necessarily say the language has moved from Louise Bennett. If you're talking about the writing system, then normally Louise Bennett would not use the modified Cassidy LePage or even the Cassidy itself. She would tend to use English, and as Charlene was explaining before, like you write in U, you'd put the H on it and try to write it as how it sounds. But certain words, for example, if she's writing pine, it would still be P-I-N-E.
Okay.
As opposed to our writing system, if we're writing pine, because it is pronounced exactly, it is written exactly as how it is pronounced, we would have P-A-I-N. Things like that.
P-A-I-N
for pine. Remember, P, these are basic, okay. where the 3 year old would yes. be able to read this.
Yes, it's
because P always pronounced P, A always pronounced A, PA together is PA, I always pronounce E, PAI, PAI, and the N, PINE, PAIN, PINE. However, the English speaker or the person who is literate in English would tend to rely on their English knowledge, looking at the word P-A-I-N, knowing that it is pain in English, will try to produce pain. Okay. But if, well, as I have done, when I was doing the launch for my books, that was done last summer, and I gave the book to a little child. He was only 6 years old, and he was able to read the book fluently. Well, not fluently in the sense that he's reading like, you know, fast, but there was no word that was mispronounced. He took his time. By that time, yeah, he took his time to read, as you would expect any 6 year old, but no word was mispronounced.
All right, I've asked them to put the numbers are up there. So if you want to call and to make your contribution to this discourse, I'd be happy to have you. What do you think, based upon what we've been discussing so far, the idea of giving Creole a prominent place in society as a language and using it for our everyday writing and speaking?
It already has a prominent place.
Yeah.
Yes, but is that place valued?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Now, the argument that we have as teachers of language, particularly English, is teaching English to our students, because the argument now is that we don't speak English, and so we have to learn English to write it and to speak it. And so many people are saying that what should be done in the classroom is that English should be taught as a foreign language. How are you?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not a foreign language. A foreign language is a language that you learn basically from books and audio tapes, because you're not living in the country where it's being spoken. For example, the Cubans that come here to learn English are learning English as a foreign language, because they're not or if we go to, if we go to the United States and we pick up Chinese, we're learning Chinese as a foreign language. Even if we go to China, because it's not a language that is in wide use in the society that you're living in. So we can't really call English a foreign language to our students. I think we say it because we're so shocked at the fact that they don't use it well. It's being called a second language, but even that has its difficulties, but it's safer to say it's a second language because it's not the mother tongue for the great majority. But it's a very complex reality because some children grow up with both languages from very early. Some children grow up, a very, very small percentage of children. When Rocky Mead did his study in Jamaica, he found that about 3% of the Jamaican children grow up with English as a mother tongue, and English only. And then on the other side, there were 3% of Jamaican children that grew up exclusively only with Jamaican patois. I would wager a guess that it's very similar here. The greater majority of our children grow up with both of the languages, but Creole is more dominant for most of them. So in fact, English has to be taught
as a second language.
Yes, as another language that they're going to need in their growing up.
So what modalities do we use in teaching English as a second language for those teachers out there who mm-hmm. might be wondering what do they mean by teaching English as a second language to our students, because we give them stories to write and according to our understanding their grammar is all over the place, their spelling is not right, mm-hmm. their mm-hmm. you know, syntax is totally mm-hmm. the way right. they put together their sentences and everything, mm-hmm. it's all wrong for us. And
yeah, so because we are not we are teaching them in a system that has discredited the language they come with. You know, I want to inject a little history and politics here. Okay. I hope what Mervyn Aline found with Guyana in the 60s when we came to independence. Mervyn Aline is a Trinidadian linguist who ended up spending most of his life in Jamaica and then later on Puerto Rico, but he has visited Guyana quite a few times too. He found that what happened when the Caribbean, the local people inherited the state, they inherited the trappings of the colonial state. So it was education, the military system, the economic system. And within that education system was English.
Okay.
So remember the state, though, the state is run by an elite. So that the children of the elite were English speakers. They became, I suppose you could accuse me of being part of that elite, because I remember growing up with English just as much as I grew up with Creolese. Right? As a matter of fact, I think I grew up with more English than Creolese. But I was always conscious that I was part of a minority. That was not what's happening in my school. The children were not speaking like me. As a matter of fact, the first day at school, a child brought that clearly to my attention.
What?
The child said to me, "You think you're white?" She said, "You think you're white, but you ain't white. Not because you could talk so."
Okay.
And then she added something else, but I wouldn't say it here.
What was your experience, Dr. Tamir?
In school?
Yeah, well,
growing up in school, uh-huh. growing up in Jamaica, in rural Jamaica, of course, my language would have been like the others, I believe. So there was never this stereotyping at all, no. But I am aware that is still an issue in Jamaica now, where, on the other hand, where your experience was a negative one, where they didn't want her to speak like that, mm-hmm. generally you have people trying to speak like the whites mm-hmm. or the foreigners. Okay. So, for example, my son, because I studied abroad, I studied in Switzerland, he was with me, so he didn't acquire much Jamaican Creole, I'm ashamed to say, even though I speak it to him all the time. But he was between French and English. So okay. I would speak Jamaican Creole to him. But when we went back home in September, I enrolled him in a school for only the period before moving to Guyana. And pretty much everyone who tried to speak to him would try to switch. They wouldn't try to speak in Creole. They would put on the accent.
The twang.
The twang.
To speak some.
To sound as if. And, you know, quite surprisingly, normally you expect that the minority should be the one who is conforming to what the majority is doing, but there is still that prestige, the notion of prestige when you speak in English.
Okay.
So to answer your question about how we teach it, the first thing we have to do is to bring that mother tongue into equal prominence with it. I cannot, to this day, I cannot think of a better way. If we continue to lock out the mother tongue at every level, right up to tertiary, because I teach at UG, somebody's calling, you could take that call.
Please look up the line so that we can take the calls if they come through. So you teach at UG.
So, yes, and the young people that come into the campus now are not English proficient. They need that course. They need to see their mother tongue, write it, read it, speak it confidently, and to know that this thing called English that we want you to learn, there's no big thing about it.
But how do you tell that to the man who is running a business, who invites an applicant for a position as a secretary or as an administrative officer or something like that, when the argument they're putting forward now is that people are leaving university and they can't write, they can't read, they can't spell, they can't produce proper...
Well, the question should be, can they do the job? That's the first question.
Okay.
There are cases where you can hire a dumb person and they will function. Or a deaf person, and they would function. I'm not being facetious. I'm saying we are caught up in this "can you produce English" thing, and we seem to forget what national development is about. It's about national development accomplishing tasks. The language that we accomplish the task in now has to be understood. And for many, many businesses, many, many entrepreneurial engagements around Guyana, let's be honest, how much English do we need? So I'm not saying I don't want the English. I'm saying if we don't recognize that it is not English that is dominant, and we keep pretending that we need English, we will not give our people that multilingual facility that we think is good for them. Because we will be forever locking the real world out in an effort to reach. Go ahead, my dear.
I'm just thinking that we still need to point out that at no point are we saying that it should be Creole and Creole alone. It is always bilingual education. So, of course, English is important. English has its place. We are not saying that we should be teaching Creole and that's it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We're merely saying that both languages should be equal.
Well, just tell us about the course again. Put up the ad on the screen so that people can see it, and then you will tell people about, and remind us what the focus is, the course will be.
Right,
what
the focus will be: learning to write, and then learning to read. We'll be presenting the class with texts that are already in existence, data collected over many years from real Guyanese speakers. We'll look at some of Uncle Stapy too. We hope that we will look at some of Wordsworth MacAndrew, even if to recognize him, the important place he's had in Guyanese society in terms of bringing our language into prominence, into valuing, being valued. And depending on who attends the class, we will be inserting some creative writing in the class as well. We would want to see what the speakers in the class can produce. It depends on who's there, but we are not locking out anybody. A friend of mine who doesn't speak Creole very well, even though we put on the press release says you have to be able to know to speak Creole. If you cannot speak Creole, if you don't feel confident, don't feel that you can't come to, because there'll be enough people in the class to give you that strength.
So the course will be run when and where?
So it's June 12th to June 30th mm-hmm. at Tain and Turkine campuses. At Tain campus, it will be on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 3 to 6. And at Turkine, it will be Mondays and Wednesdays from 5 to 8.
Okay, and the cost is?
The cost is
not a deterrent.
No, definitely. Well, the cost is, we should say, $20,000,
okay.
Ghanaese dollars. And we are still trying to put in some payment plans, maybe, or we'll see what we can do. Let's say
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, the cost should definitely not be a deterrent for you to come. Just let us know you're interested, and we'll see what we can do.
Okay, we are still open to your thoughts. If you're listening and you want to make a contribution, just call the numbers on the screen, any one of the numbers, and you'll get through to us to let us hear how you feel about giving Creole the prominence, as our linguists here are saying, that it deserves in the society. I know when you go to, Jamaica, okay, yes, we speak, but when you go to St. Lucia, you hear the guys speaking a language that we don't understand, right? The St. Lucian patois. And you just qualified it to say patois is the same
mm-hmm.
Creole, right? And they are not in any way, and to me, I get the sense that they're proud
mm-hmm.
of speaking
proud.
That language, and they use it as part of, especially when they don't want you to understand
mm-hmm.
what they're saying. Right.
But I should add that I believe Guyanese are still proud of their language.
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, the Jamaicans, well, no question about that. But what we tend to do is use it a lot when we're abroad. So back home, as in that pride comes out when we're abroad.
Okay.
That at home, you know, everybody speaks the language, so there is no major attachment to it and so on. But when you are abroad and you need to feel that sense of identity, you can't wait to hear another Guyanese so you can have a chat with them, or to feel like, yes, I'm not alone here. I don't know if I should tell my story about while I was in Geneva. It was probably around 3 months after my arrival, and I was there and not one Jamaican. Finally, I'm in the tram, and I heard someone on their phone speaking Jamaican Creole, and I was like, I got really nervous.
Okay.
I didn't know what to do. I'm like, finally, a Jamaican! I took my phone, and I started texting my friend back home, saying that, oh, there's a Jamaican on the tram. What should I do? Should I say hello or not? Because, you know, at that time, you feel like, oh, yes.
You needed somebody.
There is actually someone who you can identify with. And the person, of course, got off the tram before I could say anything. But I use that, and I generally, when you come into contact with other Jamaicans, it's like you don't want to lose them. You would say hello and you make contact, whether you keep it or not. But that sense of identity that the language affords us, which normally at home, we don't seem to cling for it. We don't seem to seek it. But abroad, we would tend to need this identity.
All right, Dr. Tamara, Delisa, and Sister Charlene Wilkinson, it's been a pleasure having you on this program. I think the discussion was quite stimulating. I hope that the viewers out there, you've given them some food for thought.
Yeah, we'd like to give them the numbers.
But
I didn't see the flyer.
Okay, the flyer wasn't up. What numbers can they get you on if they want to?
They should call the university. 222-5501. Do you have a flyer to put up for us? 222-5501. Ask for Miss Trishana. There's the. Our secretary who's handling that holiday school, or you can, should I give us their personal, our personal numbers? 691-7938
and 655-6625.
Okay, well, just get in touch with the university or get in touch with any of the two of my guests here and be a part of that special course, which will be teaching you to write Creoles. And I want to remind you again of the Day of the African Child Concert, the Pan-African Movement's concert on the 18th of June at the Queen's College Auditorium. MC Basil Bracho will be there, and along with a host of artists, will be making your day on that afternoon at 4 o'clock. The cost is $300 for adults. Children are free. And of course, you will go there. You buy your sweetmeats, you buy your African cuisine and so on, so that you can have a real good afternoon out. Well, ladies, thank you very much for being here.
Thanks.
It's been
for
a pleasure having
us.
You. And I look forward to having this kind of discussion another time with you. All right? To the people out there who have been watching, I do hope that your interest in Creoles would have been stimulated to the understanding that, well, it is a language and you should not be in any way shy to speak it whenever you have the opportunity. Do have a good night. See you next week, same time, same channel, for another program of Walter Rodney Groundings.
From the bottomless pit, but my head.